And welcome to Capital Report. I am Tom Dutchick, and we are glad that you are spending a little bit of your Sunday morning with us as we kick around the world of Connecticut politics alongside the panel, leading off with Jennifer Schneider, Communications Director for 1199 SEIU, Roy Occhio-Grosso, Managing Director, Global Strategy Group, Liz Karanowitz, a Republican strategist, GOP strategist, and Joey Latina back on the set of WTNH once again. It's been a few years, huh?
Seven.
Jeez, I think we have some. Michael, roll that tape of Jody back in the day. You know, I think we got some.
You're going to embarrass me?
No, well, come on, we're going to definitely. But look at that, huh?
Oh.
That's your basic walk and talk, huh?
That's a fresh face news channelator.
Do we know what year that?
Oh, dear. There you go.
Oh, no, now we're going through the motions.
Here you go. All right. Well, that's, hey, listen, you know, now you're back, huh?
I'm back, having fun.
Okay, well, let's get into it, guys. Last Tuesday, House Republicans outlined their budget proposals ahead of a potential budget vote. Next Tuesday, Minority Leader Themis Clarida stepped before the microphones and outlined just what kind of budget her caucus would support.
I want whatever agreement will actually make changes to the state of Connecticut and fix the problem we're in. I will not support, and the House Republicans will not support, a budget that just, as I've said before, rounds the edges of a square a little bit. Still not a circle, still a square with a little rounded of an edge. We cannot support anything that doesn't have structural changes, doesn't change the way the state of Connecticut works. Because if we don't do that, remember back in 2011, the biggest tax increase, then a few years later, the second biggest tax increase. These were going to solve all the problems that we have in the state. $5.1 billion deficit now. Not working.
Then she looked into the camera and drew a line in the sand.
The reason we're in this situation is because they can't get the votes on a Democrat budget. And I have been, and our caucus is ready, willing, and able to sit down and have those conversations. But tax increases, I don't know how else to say it, are not going to get us there. They got us to a $5.1 billion deficit.
And with the potential vote looming on Tuesday, Representative Claris made a prediction, and then she made a threat.
Do I think it's a possibility that we will vote on something on Tuesday? Yes. Do I think it's likely? No. But if we go in there to vote, I am calling the House Republican budget, and we will be getting a vote on it. And if that does not happen, there's going to be a big problem. Because, once again, you want to vote no, you have every right to vote no, and explain why you voted no. But not getting a vote on budgets that are fully vetted and ready to go is not what democracy is about.
Our communications director for 1199, you're here to represent the union peeps, right? So there's a lot to love in this Republican budget for the unions, right?
Not so much. Between breaking federal and state law to have some of the changes be made and have some of those savings actually come to fruition, ending the clean election program that Connecticut has, ending the earned income tax program, there's actually not a whole lot that I think the working people of Connecticut would really like out of this budget.
No one's breaking the law. There are some legislative fixes that can happen.
No, it is breaking federal and state law. That would absolutely be breaking the law.
I would argue that that's not right. And I do agree that the Republicans want some structural change. We are at a point now where municipalities are really hurting. And if you don't make these structural changes now, it's not going to be good for the rest of the state. People are going to start to really feel some pain. And I know that that is said over and over again, but this is the precipice. This is bad.
So let's put a point on this. The Democrats believe that these negotiations need to be done through the concession process, through collective bargaining. The Republicans want to have kind of a Wisconsin moment, for lack of a better word.
Or Rhode Island, which actually brought the state to court. So we could go through that in Connecticut as well, or we could just go with the deal that was made between the governor when the state workers went to the table in good faith, came up with $1.5 billion in savings for 2 years, $24 billion in savings over 20 years, and somehow it's not good enough for Republicans.
But even
still,
that deal's not sustainable, and you're tying the hands of policymakers and taxpayers and residents and businesses who are all saying, I give
the
up.
The deal is sustainable.
How is it sustainable?
Because it's actually helping fund the unfunded pension liability. It's lowering Medicare costs. Even in their program that they had forward, changing over to Medicare Advantage is actually part of the program that was
front-loaded savings in the first 2 years, and then everything basically gets rolled back and the savings
That's actually
disappear.
Not true. The savings actually go higher. It goes to $24 billion over 20 years, so it actually increases.
You're 4 years of no layoffs and extending a deal that this governor has said was a bad deal when it was written 20-some years ago.
Well, let's hear from Roy. Roy, yeah. Roy had actually an opportunity to negotiate these budgets back then.
First of all, there is, to Jody's point, there is structural change. Mm-hmm. You might not think it's enough, but there is structural change. And there are real savings, and you might not think they're enough, but there are more savings negotiated in this concessions deal than in any previous concessions deal in the history of Connecticut. And at some point, you have to understand that a deal is only a deal if you give something to get something. You may think too much was given and not enough was gotten, but the reality is, to do what the Republicans want, the votes simply aren't there. So we can put it on the table, but the votes aren't there.
Well, then why not put it to a vote?
I think
why
it is.
Not put it to a vote?
It may get put to a vote. I don't think the votes are there. We'll have to wait and see what happens in the House.
Well, then isn't that a problem? The details obviously are not good enough for people to vote on it. So
I think
that there's some wiggle room
a lot
there.
Of the details,
and
to
I
be
think
honest.
That taking overtime out of pension calculations is a huge thing. That never should have been in there to begin with. I mean, that is the biggest scam going. And I think that there are a lot of things in there that, yeah, they're palatable, but you cannot put a time lock on it because now you are constraining for the future.
Jody,
and that's not fair.
You can't get to a deal unless you give something. Do I think they wanted to give that up? Probably not. But the reality of negotiating inside that building, you were there.
Absolutely.
You can't always get everything you want. On balance, this is a pretty good deal.
I'm not going to disagree on you know, pretty good deal. Pretty good is not good enough anymore. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're in a situation now where you've got, you're looking at tax hikes. Everybody's answer besides the Republicans
has
been
the votes aren't
taxes.
There. Guys, we can talk about the votes are not there for what the Republicans want to do.